Good morning, everybody. My name is Maria Francesca Piacentini from the University of Rome, Italy, Foro Italico, and I will be chairing this session. Welcome to the session, Oral Presentations, PN07. And I recall to everybody that this is a Young Investigator Awards session. So to all speakers, remember you have 10 minutes of presentation, and then we will have 5 minutes of discussion, and the panel is all present, and you can see them on your screen. So I will be introducing the first speaker, and the first speaker is Andrea Pirotto from the University of Udine. And he will be presenting a paper on near-infrared spectroscopy estimation of combined skeletal muscle oxidative capacity and oxygen diffusion capacity in humans. Please.
Okay. Yes, sorry, I'm not able to share the right screen. Wait a moment. Okay, this one is right, I think. Okay, are you able to see my presentation?
We see your presenter mode.
Okay, wait.
Yeah.
Okay. So. Okay, yes, perfect. Hey, thanks for the introduction and good morning, everyone. And thanks for joining this session. And as you well know, oxygen is the main molecule necessary to produce energy for muscle contraction. And here we can see a graphical representation of oxygen cascade from ambient to skeletal muscle. Within the skeletal muscle, mitochondria utilize oxygen to produce ATP through the oxidative phosphorylation. According to the pivotal role of mitochondria, the scientific community has grown its interest in the study of mitochondria adaptation to different interventions. Over the years, the mitochondrial function has been assessed by different methods, and high-resolution respirometry is one of the most recently developed methods in human physiology. This approach estimates mitochondrial oxidation rate in permeabilized muscle fiber by measuring oxygen concentration changes after the addition of different substrates of oxidative phosphorylation. In vivo, mitochondrial function, or better defined muscle oxidative capacity, has been also assessed by non-invasive methods. Recently, muscle oxidative capacity has been estimated using near-infrared spectroscopy. For those who are not familiar with this kind of approach, NIRS is based on the measurement of oxygen deoxyhemoglobin concentration changes in the muscle capillaries by means of the near-infrared light. For measuring muscle oxidative capacity, after a few seconds of exercise, 10 to 15 brief repeated transient arterial occlusion are performed. The slope of tissue saturation index, or TSI, which corresponds to the ratio between oxyhemoglobin and total hemoglobin, are analyzed during each occlusion. Here, a graphical representation of slope values as a function of time that are interpolated by a monoexponential curve, and they represent the recovery rate constant, defined K, is used as marker for muscle oxidative capacity. This procedure relies on two important assumptions. First of all, the muscle oxidative capacity needs to be evaluated after an exercise sufficiently intense to maximally activate mitochondrial enzymes. Indeed, Vost and colleagues demonstrated that in isolated muscle fibers, exercise intensity affects muscle oxidative capacity. The second assumption requires that oxygen availability should not be limiting. Indeed, as demonstrated by Aslan and colleagues, muscle oxidative capacity here expressed as a phosphocreatine recovery rate constant is reduced from high to low values of partial pressure of oxygen concentration in the microcirculation. These assumptions are usually satisfied during the NIRS protocol by performing exercise up to 50% of the functional range that is determined by a prolonged ischemia, and then keeping the TSI in a specific range during arterial occlusions. However, muscle oxidative capacity doesn't depend only on mitochondrial function, but it's also related to oxygen diffusion. This is well described by the fixed law of diffusion, where the oxygen extraction is multiplied by muscle oxygen diffusion. This parameter is defined by many structural and functional factors related to hemodynamics, but in exercise physiology, capillary density is one of the most investigated parameters. Muscle diffusion capacity has been invasively investigated in muscle sample by light microscopy or more recently by immunofluorescence in order to evaluate capillarization. However, the limitation of these ex vivo approaches rely on their invasiveness and their translational significance in vivo. So at this point, the question is, can we measure muscle oxidative capacity in, can we measure muscle oxygen diffusion capacity in vivo? And maybe the NIRS approach a good method to investigate muscle diffusion? To answer to this question, the study aims to investigate whether near-infrared spectroscopy can estimate both skeletal muscle oxidative capacity and oxygen diffusion capacity in young healthy humans. For this study, we recruited 12 subjects, male and females. Anthropometric and physiological characteristics are reported here in the table. And each subject visits our lab in 4 different days. During the first day, a cardiopulmonary test was performed to assess VO2 peak and gas exchange threshold. On the second day, a modified NIRS protocol was performed to assess the muscle oxidative capacity. On day 3, NIRS protocol was repeated to assess the reliability. And during the last day, muscle biopsies were collected. We utilized a NIRS protocol previously described by our research group. So each subject performed 5 minutes of cycling and 80% of gas exchange threshold. And immediately after the exercise, 10 to 15 arterial occlusions were performed by cuff inflation, and muscle oxygenation was analyzed by NIRS device placed on vastus lateralis. The protocol was performed twice in the same day, and all the procedure was repeated on different days to assess the reliability of the protocol. Here we can see a TSI graph from a typical subject obtained by NIRS. On the left, we have the functional range obtained during prolonged calibration ischemia. And in the middle, we have TSI data of 5 minutes cycling, followed by repeated arterial occlusion performed in the high range, so above 50% of the physiological calibration. On the right, we have TSI data obtained after similar exercise, followed by arterial occlusions of different duration in order to keep TSI values close to the lower limit of the functional range. On day 4, muscle biopsies were taken from vastus lateralis, and mitochondrial function was analyzed by high-resolution respirometry. Due to time restriction, I will present you only data from complex 1 and complex 2 combined. Capillarization instead was assessed by analyzing capillary to fiber ratio through the immunofluorescence. Jumping to the results, on the left is present a functional range graph to highlight where high and low data were obtained. On the right, individual values for muscle oxidative capacity obtained in high and low ranges. Key values for high were consistent with data in literature for moderate and well-trained subjects. But interestingly, data obtained in low range were significantly lower than high. This highlights that muscle oxidative capacity estimation is affected by TSI range. Here we can observe data from high-resolution respirometry, where values ranged from 25 to about 55 picomoles of oxygen concentration flux normalized per wet weight. And following what was previously done in literature, we correlated mitochondrial function measured by high-resolution respirometry with muscle oxidative capacity assessed by NIRS in the 2 different ranges. In high range, the analysis revealed a good correlation, whereas for low, no correlation was found. So this suggests that NIRS is a valid approach to estimate oxidative capacity when performed in high range, whereas the estimation at low values of TSI may be affected from something more than mitochondrial function. In the next 3 slides, I will try to convince you that diffusion capacity may be involved and may play an important role. Indeed, if we calculate the difference from high to low in the muscle oxidative capacity that we define delta K, we can observe subjects with high delta K and subjects with low delta K. Here on the right are reported individual values of delta K measured in all our subjects. In this graph, data from immunofluorescence are reported. Higher values of capillary to fiber ratio can be considered an index of higher perfusion and likely better diffusion. And the opposite consideration is assumed for lower values. In these two pictures, green points represent capillaries around muscle fibers. In order to understand whether changes in muscle oxidative capacity from high to low are caused by different muscle diffusion capacity, we correlated capillary to fiber ratio to delta K. This analysis revealed a significantly inverse correlation, meaning that a greater change in muscle oxidative capacity corresponds to a lower value of capillarization, whereas the low delta K were associated to a large number of capillaries around muscle fiber, as highlighted by black points in these cartoons. So we can speculate that changes in muscle oxidative capacity in two different TSI ranges reflect muscle capillarization. So the first take-home message of our work is that muscle oxidative capacity estimation by NEOS is affected by TSI range. This result confirmed what previously was found by other approaches and confirmed the pitfalls suggested by Adani and Rossiter about NEOS protocols. The second point is that NEOS is a valid approach to estimate muscle oxidative capacity when performing high range. Indeed, our results are consistent with previous data obtained by Ryan, but the key finding of our work is that muscle oxidative capacity estimation at low TSI range did not correlate with mitochondrial function, suggesting a limiting role of muscle diffusion. Moreover, changes in muscle oxidative capacity reflecting different muscle capillarization, highlighting the possibility to use NEARS for evaluating muscle diffusion. So in conclusion, the assessment of muscle oxygenation by near infrared spectroscopy under high and low TSI ranges provides a non-invasive window not only on muscle oxidative capacity, but also on muscle oxygen diffusion capacity. These findings open the possibility to investigate the role of muscle diffusion in different fields of research, such as to investigate exercising tolerance in patients affected by different diseases, or evaluate adaptations to different training interventions, or compare physiological differences between males and females. I would like to thank all the people involved in this project and thank all of you for your attention. And now I'm ready to answer your question.
Thank you very much, Andrea, for your very clear presentation. So I am opening now the paper for discussion. If somebody from the panel has questions, please, Jatin.
Good morning, and thank you for your presentation. I've got a couple of questions. First one's just a technical clarification. So you're using sort of 10 to 15 occlusions after the exercise, and my taking is that's to capture the high and low measurements. So my question is, do you always take the same number of occlusions? So could the low be occlusion 1, 2, or 3, and the high could be occlusion 6, 7, or 8. So there's some time difference there. Is that correct?
Sorry, if I understood well, you are asking if the same number of occlusion during low range and TSI range. Yes, usually we focused on perform 12 occlusions, but sometimes happens that the occlusion was probably 11 at the maximum like 15 if the subject is compliant with the protocol.
But is there a time difference?
Yeah, but there is a time difference. This is due to in high range, the occlusion and the slope of the TSI is faster. So to keep the signal in the range, the duration of the entire protocol is really short. Then in lower end, where the slope of TSI is less steep.
So do you think that difference in rate needs to be incorporated into your delta K value?
Yeah, exactly. This is the point why we have a difference in the IK values between compared to the low values that are lower muscle oxidative capacity, and this is the point where we can calculate the difference between these two conditions.
Okay, and just a quick second question. In your abstract, you provide reproducibility data for the blood flow. Do you have similar data for your biopsy, you know, your mitochondrial respirometry?
If we have a reproducibility in ex vivo measurements, no, reproducibility, we have analyzed every single fiber, every single muscle sample in fresh, so immediately after the biopsy. So during the analysis, we split the sample in two different bundles that were analyzed and then were averaged. So we are not able to measure the reliability of the ex vivo measurement because we have only one measure made by two different muscle samples that were matched. We can't to do this analysis in fresh sample. It's not possible to analyze the reliability.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. I'll let others have got questions, I think.
Other questions from the panel?
Yeah, I've got one, Paul.
Please.
Thank you for your presentation. You came to the conclusion that near-infrared spectroscopy is a valid approach to estimate oxidative capacity. But that's based on a correlation that has an R value of 0.7. So do you see a problem in that conclusion?
No, sorry, can you repeat that? I didn't understand well.
So in your conclusion slide,
yeah,
you stated that near-infrared spectroscopy is a valid approach to measure oxidative capacity.
Yeah.
Yes. But you appear to have based that conclusion on a correlation, correct?
Yeah.
But the correlation only explains 50% of the variance in the relationship. So in any, you know, in a biochemical method, you would be looking for an R squared value well above 0.9 for validity. So why do you conclude based on an R value of 0.7 that it's a valid method?
If I understood well, we concluded that MIRS protocol is a valid approach to estimate mass oxidative capacity because we have a significant correlation between the high range values, so the measurement made above 50% of the functional range. This is well correlated with measured in vivo measurement from high resolution spectroscopy.
It wasn't well correlated. It was an R square value of 0.49. So only 49% of the variance is explained by this relationship. And I would say that's not really showing a reliable validity measure. And I was going to ask you, are there any other approaches you could have used?
Okay, so the problem is from a statistical point of view, but the significant was
from a variability point of view, not statistics.
The variability of this measurement is a limitation for this protocol, but the Pearson coefficient was really good, was 0.72, if I remember well. But also the p-value was significant. I don't remember exactly the number.
I think we have a difference of opinion. I would not consider a p-value of 0.72 as a good measure of validity.
Okay.
Clearly, you believe it is, but okay.
Okay, I have to interrupt you, sorry. We need to move on. Thank you very much, Andrea, for your presentation.
Thank you, too.
And we will now move to the next speaker, Angel Gallego Celes from the University of Las Palmas de Gran Canaria. And he will present in a paper on fast activation, deactivation of the NFKB signaling pathway in human skeletal muscle, role of oxygenation and metabolite accumulation. Okay, I think there is a problem. Angel? Here, okay.
Hello?
Yes, could you
Sorry,
please?
Sorry, I have a lag. The screen is.
Yes, could you please share your presentation? Yes, it's your turn.
Yeah, of course. No, yes. Well, thanks for the introduction. NFKB protein include a family of structurally related transcription factors that are involved in the control of over 150 target genes and play a key role in many biological processes such as inflammation, immunity, and metabolism. NFKB proteins consist of 5 members that form dimeric complexes to translocate to the nucleus. Under resting conditions, NFKB complexes are held in the cytoplasm in an inactive state bound to regulatory protein member of the NFKB inhibitor family called IKB. Upon stimulation, NFKB is activated by extracellular signals like TNF-alpha and intracellular chains in calcium, inorganic phosphate, metabolites, and RONs. RONs are needed for exercise adaptation, and RONs sensitive kinase, such as MAPK and CAN kinase 2, have been shown to activate NFKB signaling in some experimental models. NFKB induction signals, such as ERK12 and P38, are phosphorylated and active a cascade of events, resulting in the phosphorylation of IKK, which is IKB kinase. Activated IKK phosphorylate IKB for proteasomal degradation, releasing NFKB for nuclear translocation. IKK also phosphorylate NP65 when it's necessary for its nuclear localization. Then NFKB promotes kappa B genes transcription. These genes encode cytokines such as IL-6. Canonical NFKB activity depends mostly on P65 and P50 dimer. STAT3 ROS mediated activation interact with NFKB for inflammatory functions. During exercise, RONs are produced primarily depending on the intensity and the fitness level, which are accompanied by changes in metabolites, oxygen pressure, and signaling molecules such as calcium, phosphocreatine, or hydrogen ion. These changes in metabolite accumulation and RONs are exacerbated by hypoxia. Although these signs are present in contracted muscles, contradicting findings have been reported regarding the effect of exercise on NFKB signaling. Therefore, or elsewhere, to determine whether NFKB signaling is activated by acute exercise in human skeletal muscle and whether muscle oxygenation and metabolite accumulation play a role in this process. We also aim to determine the time course of NFKB signaling during the early recovery and to establish whether NFKB signaling remains activated by the application of post-exercise chemo. Our hypothesis was that NFKB signaling is more activated during exercise in severe acute hypoxia than is further activated during post-exercise chemo. We also hypothesized that NFKB signaling will return to pre-exercise level within 1 minute after exercise when the muscle recover with free circulation. After a resting biopsy, 11 volunteers performed an incremental exercise to exhaustion, inner moxia, and hypoxia on different days in random order. At exhaustion, a calf was inflated to complete the blood the circulation of one leg during 60 seconds, while the contralateral leg recovered with free circulation. Following exhaustion, one biopsy was taken 10 seconds and 60 seconds from the occluded leg, and simultaneously another biopsy was taken 60 seconds from the non-occluded leg. Therefore, muscle metabolism protein expression were measured in biopsy from the pastus lateralis before exercise, 10 seconds after exercise, and 60 seconds after exercise bilaterally from the occluded and the non-occluded legs. As previously reported, muscle lactate, phosphocreatine, and ATP change similarly after exercise in normoxia and hypoxia. From 10 to 60 seconds, muscle lactate only increased in the occluded leg, and PCR was reduced by almost 100% in the occluded leg, but 50% in the non-occluded leg. In line with a similar metabolic accumulation after exercise in hypoxia and normoxia, ANOVA analysis showed that signaling response of all measured proteins here were similar in both conditions. When comparing ISO4D, OS4 and total calcineurin A2, both were increased after exercise and 1 minute of occlusion, and returned to pre-exercise value only after recovery with free circulation. IgG alpha and beta activatory phosphorylation and IgG alpha total protein were also increased immediately after exercise, and after 1 minute of occlusion, they returned to pre-exercise values after just 1 minute in the leg recovering with free circulation. Interestingly, IgG beta total protein did not change. Phospho P65 and P65 total protein increased after exercise, returning to baseline level within 1 minute after exercise in the non-occluded leg. The protein content was lower in the leg, recovering with free circulation, than in the occluded one. P50, P105, and the liver P60, P50 increased after exercise and after 1 minute of occlusion. They returned to pre-exercise value after 1 minute recovery with open circulation. Significant changes were found 1 minute after exercise between the occluded and the non-occluded leg. IgB beta phosphorylation and total amount of IgB beta protein increased remarkably after exercise, parallel to NFGB signaling. On the other side, IgB alpha protein was reduced at the end of the exercise by 20% and further reduced during ischemia. The ratio between phospho and total STAT3 was increased immediately after exercise and returned to pre-exercise value only after 60 seconds in the leg recovering with free circulation. IL-6 expression was reduced by 30% immediately after exercise. This study shows that during incremental exercise to exhaustion, NFGB signaling is activated to a similar extent in normoxia and severe acute hypoxia. NFGB response is associated with the activating phosphorylation of cankinase 2 delta T isoform and involves an increase in IgG alpha and IgB beta. As expected, the elevation of P50 was parallel to P105. The coordinated increase of P65 and P50 may have facilitated the nuclear translocation of the dimer and the transactivation of NFGB target genes. This is supported by the increase of P65 phosphorylation. IgB beta phosphorylation increased remarkably in response to exhaustion, likely because of by its upstream kinase phospho IgG, which is increased largely. IgB alpha protein was reduced at the end of the exercise. Then we have shown a different regulation of IgB alpha and IgB beta in human skeletal muscle. The effect of exercise on the protein level of IgG alpha and beta have not been previously studied in human skeletal muscle. Here we have observed a differential regulation between these two subunits. Most components of NFGB signaling quickly return to pre-exercise level within 1 minute unless metabolic recovery and reoxygenation are prevented by the instantaneous application of ischemia. This is a new experimental model developed in humans to impede early recovery through the instantaneous application of completed post-exercise ischemia, highlighting the importance of obtaining the muscle biopsy as close as possible to the end of the exercise. This finding implies that post-exercise ischemia could be used as to prolong the exercise-induced activation of NFGB and the associated adaptive response. Thank you for your time, and now I'm ready for the questions.
Thank you very much, Angel, for your very nice presentation. And I was wondering if there are questions. Okay, thank you. Jatin, please.
Good morning, and thank you for a nice presentation. I just wondered, you know, based on your data, whether you think that the NF-kappa B signaling is an important part of adaptation to this part, to this type of exercise.
Okay. Using this the same model, we studied the upregulation of different kinases like antioxidant enzymes. We saw that enzymes like catalase increase similarly to NF-kappa B signaling. So we think that NF-kappa B play a key role in the adaptation to exercise, the antioxidant enzymes, the pro-inflammatory cytokines.
But if I'm not mistaken, you showed a decrease in IL-6 expression. Surely you'd expect that to increase?
Yes, we expect it to increase, but based on the literature, we think that the IL-6 was in exocytosis, it was right outside the muscle. So you need to have a different, longer time point to be able to find the IL-6 increase after exercise.
And the catalase data that you mentioned, what time point was that?
The same thing, the same one that we use now, 10 seconds and 60 seconds after the exercise. So catalase was increased, but IL-6 was seems to be decreased at the beginning, but we think that if, in a new study, if we have like a longer time point, we will find an increase in IL-6.
So I'm just wondering, how do you think catalase is increased 60 seconds after exercise through NF-kappa B? Because that presumably means that there's regulatory change, you know, signaling changes in NF-kappa B and I-kappa B, like you've shown, transcription and translation of catalase in order for it to change in 60 seconds.
Yes, we think so. There are some papers studying antioxidant enzymes like SOT1, SOT2, relate in the relationship with NF-kappa B. We found the same relationship between that, the same time points. And also we studied the NRF2 pathway and increased similarly to NF-kappa B. So we think the antioxidant is activated.
Thank you. I'll let others ask questions if they have them.
I have a question, please. But if any colleagues want to ask, it's fine, but I've got one if I may. So thank you for your presentation. I just want to ask you about your conclusion that you saw post-exercise ischemia maintained NF-kappa B activation. And you concluded this suggests that reoxygenation after exercise is necessary to deactivate NF-kappa B. But you saw that under conditions of occlusion. So there's no efflux of lactate from the muscle during occlusion, for example. And it's likely that potassium and sodium flux are altered. It's also likely that calcium flux is altered. So why do you focus on its reoxygenation that's the key? Because the ischemia will have several other effects, is what I'm saying.
Okay, so it was just because as there was differences between the occluded and non-occluded leg, we think that the reoxygenation was the main cause of this difference between the protein levels. But of course, we haven't done the relationship with metabolites yet. But of course, there should be a relationship between them.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I would thank you, Angel, for your presentation. I would move on to the next speaker?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, which is Mizuki Takaragawa.
Yes.
Said it correctly. Okay, that will be presenting a paper, Associations of Iron Status Related TMPRS six TSC polymorphism with muscle fiber composition and physical performance.
Can you see my slide?
Can you see my slide?
Yes. You can start.
Thank you. Thank you for chairperson. Today, I'd like to talk about Association of Iron Status Related TMPRSS6 RS855791 P2C polymorphism based muscle fiber composition and physical performance. Human skeletal muscle is composed of serotonin type 1 and fibrosis type 2 fibers, and type 2 fibers are further classified into type 2A and type 2X. As shown in this slide, these fibers have different metabolic characteristics. So in the individual differences, a muscle fiber composition is associated with physical performance. Human muscle fiber composition is strongly influenced by genetic factors. However, a large part of the genetic factors determining muscle fiber composition is still unclear. Previous animal studies reported that iron status is associated with muscle fiber composition in humans as well. So we focused on the iron status. Left figure shows the effect of iron deficiency on muscle fiber composition. The white bar shows iron deficiency group, and red bar shows control group. Iron deficiency group shows lower percentage of type 1 fiber and higher percentage of type 2A and type 2X fibers compared with control. Similar result was found in another study. These data suggest that iron status may be related to muscle fiber composition in human. Human body doesn't have a physiological pathway for the excretion of iron. So iron status in our body is regulated by only by absorption. Hepcidin is main regulator of iron status, which is a negative regulator. When the blood is saturated with iron, hepcidin inhibits the iron absorption. Hepcidin concentration is mainly regulated by hemoglobin BMP smart pathway. This pathway is regulated by matriptase 2. Matriptase 2 is encoded by the TMPRSS6 gene. Within this gene, there is a RS855791 T2C functional polymorphism, which causes bind to alanine amino acid replacement. Previous studies showed that this SNP has a strong relationship with iron status. TT genotype of this polymorphism is associated with lower iron status. On the other hand, CC genotype is associated with higher iron status. So we have hypothesized that TR is associated with high proportion of fast twitch fiber and high sprint bar performance. In contrast, CR is associated with low proportion of fast twitch fiber and high endurance performance. We aimed to examine the associations of the TMPR SS6RS855791T2C polymorphism related to iron status with muscle fiber competition and iron status in athlete and athlete status. To examine the associations between TMPR SS6T2C polymorphism and muscle fiber competition, we recruited a total of 214 Japanese individuals. Muscle biopsy were taken from bust lateralis, and myosin heavy chain isoforms are measured by SDS page. Genetic polymorphism was analyzed by Tekman SNP genotyping assay. Here is result of study one. This slide shows the percentage of myosin heavy chain isoforms of TT, TC, and CC genotype groups by type 1, type 2A, and type 2X for all participants, males and females. White bar shows TT genotype, which is associated with lower iron status, and red bar shows CC genotype, which is associated with higher iron status in previous studies. In all participants, TR carriers chose lower type 2A according to number of TRL. Namely, TT genotype showed the lowest type 2A, CC genotype showed the highest type 2A, and TC genotype showed intermediate. Similarly, in female participants, CR carriers showed lower type 2A according to number of TRL. In contrast, TR carriers showed higher type 2X according to number of TRL. There was no significant association in males. Next, to examine the association between TMPR SS6T2C polymorphism and iron status in athletes, we recruited 149 Japanese male track and field athletes for study 2. After 12 hours of fasting, we measured hematological parameters related to iron status using blood samples. Then, to examine the association between this polymorphism and elite athlete status, we also recruited 135 Japanese elite track and field athletes, including 78 endurance athletes and 57 sprinter athletes for study 3. They are all international level. Here is the result of study 2. This slide shows the hematological parameters of each genotype in athlete. TR carrier shows lower serum iron level according to number of TRL. This data shows similar relationships to previous studies using general population. The other variables highlighted in blue and red also showed similar relationship to previous studies. This data indicates that this polymorphism is associated with iron status in athlete. Here is result of study 3. TRE is associated with elite sprint power athlete status. Sprint power athlete showed higher frequency of TT genotype and lower frequency of CC genotype compared with controls. Similar results were found when compared with elite endurance athlete. These tendencies were stronger females. similar to the muscle fiber composition, there was no significant association in males. Our data suggests that RS855791T2C polymorphism in TMPRSS6 is associated with not only muscle fiber competition, but also elite sprint power acid status, especially in females. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for your presentation. And specifically, I acknowledge also the very high number of subjects that were actually recruited for the study. I was just wondering before leaving the possibility of questions to the floor, if you could speculate a bit more on the sex differences that you found. That females,
I'm sorry, I don't catch your question. Could you speak more slowly, please?
Sorry. This trend that you found was stronger, was significant in females, both in the controls and then in the athletes.
Generally, the women have lower iron status, and women in iron intake does not achieve the recommendation in dietary reference intake for Japanese. Thereby, women may be chronic iron insufficiency compared with men. So I think that we find the significant association between genetic polymorphism and muscle fiber competition in women.
Okay. Thank you. Are there other questions from the panel? Please, Jatin.
Hello. Thank you for your presentation. At the beginning, you started by saying that 53% of the variance in fiber type is genetically determined. I wondered, do you have any data to show what contribution this particular gene makes towards that 53%?
Maybe the PGC1 alpha actinin 3 is H1RA.
So it is.
Has reverted the previous study.
So the association that you show with fiber type for this gene, is that association stronger or weaker than, for example, actinin 3?
I don't know exactly. Maybe it's about.
I don't know about the contribution.
I don't know contribution. As a gene. PRSS6 can explain 10% for type 2A and 6% for type 2X fibers in females.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, thank you, Mizuki. We will pass to the next speaker.
Thank you
very much. The next speaker is Vilde Handegard. From the Norwegian School of Sports Science, she'll be talking about muscle damaging exercise increases myofibrillar calcium sensitivity.
Thank you for the introduction, Chair. Can you hear me? Yeah. Okay, good. So, we do know that unaccustomed maximal eccentric contractions causes a rapid and often long-lasting reduction in force-generating capacity. The mechanisms behind are not fully elaborated, but there's clear evidence for sarcomere disruptions, which can be evident for weeks, impaired excitation-contraction coupling, which have been shown to last for at least 5 days after eccentric contractions, and altered myofibrillar calcium sensitivity. This could occur if the redox status of troponin was changed, as this is where calcium binds. Calcium sensitivity has been shown to be reduced immediately after stretch contractions, but we know little about the following days of recovery. So muscle activity, as we know, increases the production of reactive oxygen species, or ROS, causing a shift in the redox balance. And the myofibrillar calcium sensitivity depends upon redox status, among other. It has been shown that ROS may contribute to force depression by affecting the myofibrillar calcium sensitivity and or calcium release from sarcoplasmic reticulum. In theory, increased oxidative stress or a shift in redox balance may both increase and decrease the maximum single fiber force and calcium sensitivity of the contractile apparatus. In the top figure, you can see that hydrogen peroxide together with myoglobin can form hydroxyl radicals, which could decrease calcium sensitivity. However, both hydrogen peroxide and hydroxyl radicals can react with glutathione and form thiol radicals. These thiol radicals can then S-glutathionylate, a highly reactive cysteine residue, which is present in fast twitch fibers, and this would lead to an increased calcium sensitivity. The bottom figure illustrates that the duration of exposure of, for example, hydrogen peroxide could both increase and decrease the maximum force depending on basal redox status of the muscle. In this study by Molika and co-workers from 2012, they found clear evidence for S-glutathionylation occurring in fast twitch fibers, causing a large increase in calcium sensitivity with the application of glutathione. This was then reversed by application of the reducing agent DTT. And with extracted troponin I, Western blot confirmed S-glutathionylation of troponin I by glutathione. This was also found to occur in fast twitch fibers from human muscles that had performed exercise of moderate intensity. Hence, the objective of the study was to investigate the changes in contractile properties after eccentric contractions and see if changes in redox status may have occurred and further influence the results. Our hypothesis was that eccentric contractions would increase calcium sensitivity due to increased oxidative stress. In this study, our participants performed 50 eccentric contractions unilaterally with the elbow flexors. The contralateral arm served as a control. before and in the minutes, hours, and days after eccentric work, we measured maximal force generating capacity in the elbow flexors. We collected muscle tissue samples from the biceps brachii, and we collected venous blood samples before and in the hours and days after the eccentric work. I'll give you a brief overview of the single fiber experiment protocol used to measure maximum single fiber force and myofibrillar calcium sensitivity. First, we isolated fibers, obtained an image of the fiber along with a calibration stick to determine fiber cross-sectional area. Then we mounted the fiber between a force transducer and a pin. Further, we submerged the fiber in Triton X100 to chemically skin the fiber. After skinning, we did a maximal calcium activation of the fiber before doing a stepwise immersion in increasing calcium solutions. So PCA 6.7 equals to zero calcium, while PCA 4.7 elicits maximum calcium activated force. Further, we submerged the fiber for 10 minutes in the reducing agent DTT. This would lead to a reduction of initially oxidized molecules. After DTT treatment, we repeated the stepwise protocol to see if we obtained different results. Participants were healthy, young, and untrained. Initially, we included 15 participants, but the single fiber analysis were only performed on a subsample of the final five participants. We analyzed 84 fibers from these five subjects, where there was a clear overweight of type 2 fibers. And below the table, you can see an example of the blot with the analysis of myosin heavy chain isoform. Data were analyzed by curve fitting using nonlinear regression, and the results from curve fitting were analyzed for main and interaction effects of myosin heavy chain isoform condition and redox status. Our results show a rapid decrease in force generating capacity for the exercised arm before a slow recovery from 48 hours after eccentric contractions. For these five subjects, there were no change in creatine kinase, indicating that these were not suffering from severe muscle damage, including necrosis. However, they might be suffering from mild to moderate muscle damage anyway. And our results for myoglobin showed the same pattern. Single fiber specific force was reduced after being treated with reducing agent, but only in the type 2 fibers. Type 1 fibers did not show any change after the same treatment. However, keep in mind that we have a very low number of type 1 fibers that were analyzed. The reduction in the specific force for type 2 fibers from both exercised and control arms suggests that type 2 fibers would be in the middle left of this curve, and that oxidation to some degree might be beneficial for the single fiber force. The hill slope was affected by, of course, the myosin heavy chain isoform, as you can see in these two figures, but also by the redox status. However, there were no change in the slope of the curves after eccentric contractions. The calcium sensitivity was significantly increased in type 2 fibers after eccentric contractions compared to control. Treatment with reducing agent caused a decrease in the calcium sensitivity, suggesting that oxidation leading to increased calcium sensitivity was reversible. To your left, you can see the type 1 fibers, not showing any change in calcium sensitivity, while type 2 fibers to your right show a clearly rightward shift in the curve after being treated with reducing agent, indicating a decreased calcium sensitivity. And this effect was larger in the fibers from the exercised arm. And I think that these figures illustrate very well the effect of the reducing agent. So to sum up, specific pores of type 2 fibers were decreased after being treated with a reducing agent. This indicates that type 2 fibers have a more optimal basal redox balance. Further, we found that 48 hours after eccentric contractions, calcium sensitivity was increased in type 2 fibers only, and that this is probably due to alteration in redox status and S-glutathionylation of troponin I in fast twitch fibers. Malika and co-workers show compelling evidence as this only occurs in fast twitch fibers and is fully reversible by applying a reducing agent such as DTT. I would like to thank our collaborators at the University of Southern Denmark and thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for your nice and clear presentation. And I will ask the panel for possible questions.
Thank you for that nice presentation and a lot of work. The question on, you're saying you're actually, you're making a conclusion based on the time point of 48 hours after exercise. Of course, with eccentric exercise, you might have delayed onset muscle soreness up to 72 hours. Can you speculate on your results if you would have applied a 24 and a 72 hour difference? And how would the difference between your type 2 and your type 1 fibers be?
Well, that's the demanding question.
I know, but you still got a few years left.
Yeah, that's true. With regards to the specific force of the fiber, we were actually a bit surprised that they did not decrease the specific force, as we saw this in the whole muscle or in vivo. So that was a bit unexpected, but I guess that there could be some kind of selection bias towards selecting fibers that were not the most damaged. Maybe that they broke during isolation or whatever. We also have to keep in mind that these fibers are skinned, and so we only have the contractile apparatus available and not the other force bearing structures, which I guess would show us another result if we had them in addition.
And probably all of those tissues have a different timeline in their responsiveness.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Could I ask?
I'm not sure if I answered your question.
No, I mean, you basically said that that there's still a lot of questions, but I was just selecting think that your differences would be greatest when the delayed onset muscle soreness would be the highest or the strongest.
There's after this kind of exercise, people, almost everyone that do this, if they're unaccustomed and untrained, they show a very rapid decline as we have here. And then from 48 hours and onwards, you usually see a difference between the persons that get rhabdomyolysis. They won't start to recover until maybe 96 hours or later even. But these subjects were actually starting their recovery at 48 hours. And so 48 hours is sort of a breaking point between the people getting the more severe muscle damage and the ones getting mild to moderate muscle damage. So I would characterize these subjects as mild to moderately affected.
I understand your choice of your timeline better now. Thanks.
I was interested that, thank you for a nice, very nice presentation. I was interested about the fiber selectivity you've unearthed, but do you know whether the magnitude of eccentric induced damage was the same between fiber types? That is, could the type 2 fibers be more damaged, and therefore this is why you see a bigger effect of the DTT?
Well, yes, type 2 fibers are more prone to this kind of muscle damage after eccentric contractions, and so definitely would expect to see more or see the more severe damage in the type 2 fibers compared to the type 1 fibers.
Thank you.
Yes, just a quick question. So you speculate the change in calcium sensitivity is due to reversible oxidative modifications of, you know, troponin I or other proteins, but you show that change occurs still at 48 hours after the exercise. So I was wondering how you think the redox status of the muscle is perturbed for such a long time.
Well, yeah, that's a good question, and I've been trying to find the answer to a somewhat similar question I had myself. What I'm thinking is that it might have something to do with the whole perturbed homeostasis of the muscle due to the muscle damage, but I'm afraid I won't be able to give you a more detailed answer than that at this time.
And then just a very quick question. When you do your calcium gradient, you go stepwise, you know, incrementally. Is that usual, or should you go, you know, sort of randomly across the calcium gradient?
Well, at least from the studies I read, it's usual. You usually do the stepwise incremental. Because, well, of course, it's less time consuming than if you had to do a random submersion in different calcium concentrations, because then you risk contaminating the different solutions. Because if you go from very high to very low calcium or vice versa, then you might contaminate those solutions, and then you would have to like have a washout between each solution. And so and then after submerging, you also have to wait for a steady state force recording before you can change the solution. And so the whole experiments with all these solutions and doing it twice is very time consuming. So it's more practical question of practicality, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much. We need to move on. So thank you, Vita, for your presentation. And we will move to the next speaker, Elise Lander from the Norwegian School of Sports Science. And the presentation will be about the dual ability of low load blood flow restricted exercise, similar muscle growth, but augmented increase in mitochondrial proteins compared to high load resistance exercise. Please.
Good day, and thank you for the introduction. My name is Elise Lander, and I will now present the study investigating the dual ability of low-load blood flow restriction training, here on referred to as low-load BFR. And this is a part of a larger study, which was a collaboration between the Norwegian School of Sports Sciences and the University of Queensland, with aim to directly compare low-load BFR to high-load resistance training. Blood flow restriction training is a training regime where an inflatable cuff is used to create pressure on the exercising muscle. And this causes inhibition of venous blood flow and also reduced arterial blood flow in the exercising muscle, leading to a blood pooling in the muscle. And the aim is to reduce mechanical load while still enhancing muscle growth. And even though there are distinct differences in the ways low load BFR and high load resistance training promote affects skeletal muscle, exercising with low load BFR has been shown to promote muscle hypertrophy in a similar manner as high load resistance training, and can stimulate myofibrillar protein synthesis, ribosomal biogenesis, as well as increase muscle stem cells. And there are several benefits proposed with BFR training, such as time efficient weight to exercise, quality exercise to populations having difficulties using heavy loads, for example, elderly, frail or injured. It offers the possibility to reduce total training stress during busy competitive periods, which may reduce the risk of injuries. Or it can be used as a maintenance of muscular strength during periods with reduced training, such as deloading or tapering. Interestingly, low-load BFR seem to have a dual ability, as studies have shown that low-load BFR, in addition to improve muscle mass and strength, also may enhance muscle fiber oxidative metabolism through mitochondrial and capillary adaptation. And this would provide an efficient way to simulate both the capacity to produce force and to improve the muscular endurance. There is, however, limited information about the mitochondrial adaptation to low-load BFR training, as you can see from the table. From these few studies, there are results pointing to increased effect on mitochondrial adaptation when exercising with low-load BFR, but the information is limited due to the relatively low exercising volume and short training intervention, and also a low recruitment of women. Also, the Grunebeck study, which is the only one directly comparing low-load BFR to high-load resistance training, is done on untrained subjects, whereas no study has investigated such muscular adaptation to low-load BFR in resistance-trained subjects. So the aim of this study was to compare the effect of low-load BFR in high-load resistance training on changes in muscle cross-sectional area, mitochondrial enzymes, and muscular endurance. And when low-load BFR is compared to high-load resistance training, we hypothesized that it would be similar hypertrophy and a greater increase in mitochondrial enzyme levels and muscular endurance capacity with low-load BFR. The study included healthy, strength-trained adults aged between 18 to 35 who had performed frequent resistance training for the last 2 years, and the subject characteristics are presented on the right side. They were randomized into two groups, either with low-load BFR or high-load resistance training, and they completed 9 weeks of lower body strength training consisting of 2 to 3 exercises 3 times per week. The study lasted for 12 weeks, which included familiarization and pretest the 2 first weeks, followed by 9 weeks of strength exercise and 1 week of post-testing. And the exercise volume and frequency were reduced during training week 5 to promote recovery and adaptation. And as you can see, several tests were performed in this project. And for this presentation, I will focus on the measurements of cross-sectional area of quadriceps, muscular endurance, and biopsies obtained from vastus lateralis before and after the 9-week training period. The resistance training program included the exercises barbell back squat, leg press, Bulgarian split squat, and leg extension, and all the participants were supervised during all training sessions. For low-load BFR, the training load was set to 30% of 1 RM and 60% arterial occlusion pressure. For each exercise, they performed 1 set of 30 repetitions and 3 sets of 15 repetitions. With a 45 seconds continuous occlusion intercept recovery time. High-load resistance training had a training load of 8 to 10 RM, where they performed 4 sets of 8 repetitions and had 120 seconds intercept recovery time. And for both conditions, training loads were adjusted during the intervention to ensure that participants exercised to muscular failure. The muscle cross-sectional area of quadriceps was determined using MRI, and muscle endurance was assessed as total work during 50 sequential isokinetic knee extension contractions at a speed of 90 degrees per second. The biopsies were homogenized and analyzed using Western blots for the mitochondrial enzymes, HUB, citrate synthase, and COX-4. And the statistics were done with 2-way ANOVA for repeated measures and 2-tailed piercing coefficient for correlation. And here you can see the mitochondrial enzymes we investigated involved in the fatty acid oxidation for HAD, the tricarboxylic acid cycle for citrate synthase, and oxidative phosphorylation for COX-4, which all have important roles in the energy production of ATP. The CSI of quadriceps increased 4.6 after high-load resistance training and 7.4% after low-load VFR, with no difference between groups. And no significant change was observed in muscular endurance after high-load resistance training. The low-load VFR increased muscle endurance 11%, and there was a tendency for group effect in the relative change between groups. A time and group interaction effect was found for the relative change in mitochondrial enzymes, where low-load BFR increased significantly 48% for low-load for COX-4, 21% for citrate synthase, and non-significantly 15% for HAD, whereas high-load resistance training decreased the enzyme levels, causing a significant difference in the relative change in mitochondrial enzyme levels between the two training interventions in favor of low-load BFR. And the changes in COX further correlated with the changes in muscular endurance, with a Pearson-R coefficient of 0.6. So the conclusion is that low-load BFR had a similar hypertrophic potential as high-load resistance training. Low-load BFR increased levels of mitochondrial enzymes, and the changes in mitochondrial enzymes translated into altered muscle function. Our results therefore support the suggestion of a dual ability of low-load BFR to enhance both the capacity to produce force and to improve the muscular endurance, as we saw an effect on both mitochondrial and myofibrillar adaptation to increase CSI. Aligning our results with the previous comparable study done by Brunnebeck and colleagues, we can see that the results are favoring the use of low-load BFR, although there are still need for more investigations in both trained and in untrained subjects. Nonetheless, the similar effect on muscle mass and the distinct difference in the mitochondrial changes in our study highlights the importance of considering both aspects when exercise guidelines are given to athletes and clinical populations. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you very much for your nice presentation. I just have a quick question. So what do you think your the results from the previous studies? You said, you know, they were testing untrained subjects and you had trained subjects. Why would you expect to see something different from the previous results?
Well, when we have seen at in other studies with resistance training, there are, when subjects are trained, they show different adaptation to the training and then normally need more stimulus than untrained subjects. So I guess that would be the reason why I would expect to see something different, at least.
Okay, thank you. Other, Jatin, please.
Morning, thank you for your presentation. I was wondering, because you've got, how do you know that the mitochondrial response is due to the blood flow restriction and not due to the greater number of repetitions that the those participants did?
That's actually a really good question, because the volume was actually, even though the volume was lower for the low-load BFR in the beginning of the study, they actually increased their volume load during the training intervention much more than the high-load resistance training in our study. So obviously it could be a question about just the volume load. And then you have for the mitochondrial adaptations, when there is low oxygen over a longer period of time compared to what you would expect in high-load resistance training, you would probably see it a more increased, reduced energy availability, which could activate AMPK, which would then phosphorylate PGC alpha, which is part of starting the transcription expression of the mitochondrial proteins.
Okay. And my second question is, so you're comparing this data with the work done from your lab in 2018. And you highlighted some weaknesses there, such as the duration and low number of females. So what does your new data add based on the fact that you've gone from 6 weeks to 9 weeks duration? So is your data, you know, what does your data add above the other publication? And is there any specific sex-specific differences that you were able to find by including more females?
I've not investigated any sex differences due to the relatively low number in each group, which would be a bit difficult. But the added value, I would say that we do have a more relatable number of exercise to athlete populations. So I would say that it's more relevant for any athletes that would like to use this exercise regime, which is different from the untrained subjects.
And also, was the response different though between the previous study and this study?
Sorry?
Was the mitochondrial response notably different between this study and the previous published work?
The previous work showed more similar adaptations in both training interventions, whereas we showed different. So it could be that the extended training session, training exercises that we had more, just the larger volume really, could show the differences.
Okay, thank you.
We have time for another quick question.
Wendrab from Ghent University. Could you speculate on the recruitment of the different fiber types in your two experimental conditions, which expands a bit on the question that Jatin asked, but specific towards the fiber type activation level of your two interventions?
Yeah, obviously, good follow-up question. Loaded BFR is assumed to improve the type 1 fibers in a larger extent than you would see with high loads resistance training. And therefore, the motor recruitment could be higher with low-load BFR during the training, which also would probably show some effect in the muscular endurance adaptations. Your question.
Okay, thank you very much. Time is up. So thank you, Liz, for your presentation or your contribution to this session. And this session is officially closed. So we have heard and listened to all the presentations of all these Young Investigators Awards. And thank you to all participants and to everybody who joined us online. And I wish you to everybody a nice continuation of the Congress. Thank you very much.